of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands, he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in love, commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns.
Well, good morning, friends. Once again, I want to welcome you to our streaming service here at Burnt Factory United Methodist Church. We are so pleased that you have decided to join us on this beautiful day that the Lord has made. And I do welcome you in the precious and wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. This is indeed the day that the Lord has made. Let us all rejoice and be glad in it. I want to take just a brief moment this morning to show you once again the fruitfulness of your great generosity, the wonderful outpouring of support that once again you have bestowed upon the community that we live in here. Bright Futures is a wonderful organization that helps kids with needs that they may have to continue their education. So we have, I've lost track. We've got so many backpacks. We've got so many school supplies that have been donated so that some of our youngest students can have what they need to learn. And we are just, once again, so thankful for your outpouring. Will you pray with me as we bless these gifts? Almighty and most gracious God, we thank you for the outpouring of love and support for Bright Futures, this wonderful organization that helps so many of our youngest students. We give you praise for their service in the community, and we thank you for these gifts. We consecrate them to you, Lord. May those children who use these gifts know the love of Jesus Christ. We ask your blessings upon them. In the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. At this time, I'll invite Rob to come forward as we begin our service this morning. Rob?
Good morning. Is God good or what? God has shown that He is benevolent and kind and compassionate, and He shows that through you. We are blown away and so thankful for your generosity that you're still in mission, still seeing a need, and still responding. Thanks be to God. Thank you for the congregation that blesses us all. Thank you so much. Another blessing I want to bring your attention to is this Tuesday. If you have the opportunity, we have our 2-4 BLT, our second and fourth Tuesdays, bag lunch Tuesdays, that we meet down at the shelter. Come, bring your lunch. It's time for fellowship. If you have the opportunity, it's this Tuesday at noon. So hopefully you can make it. It is a wonderful day, as Steve has said. It's wonderful, for God is in control, and we give him thanks. I ask you at this time if you would join with me in our opening prayer. May we pray. Almighty God, in physical pain, mental stress, and emotional wounds, we ask for your comfort and peace. Calm our fears and grant us patience to see clearly your call on our lives. May we bind with your Spirit to have hope and to give hope to the suffering. Strengthen us to overcome the challenges of the world and rest in your promises of eternal glory. Touch us, Lord. We come together to praise the God of healing. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. My friends, would you join with me as we proclaim with confidence our faith in an ever-loving God? Would you join with me in the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. All right, children's time. And we are so blessed to have those famous Reed sisters give us our introduction and lead into Carrie's lesson this morning. So thanks so much to Lily Eva, and we think Kate's in there somewhere. But listen to these wonderful angelic voices as we come to children's time.
Just down here at the church shelter reading my Bible and spending some time with God. And I was reading in Luke chapter 5 because that is what Pastor Steve is going to be preaching on for a little while. And so as I started to reading and getting into the scriptures, I noticed that the Bible in the New Testament has some amazing healing passages, and one of them in particular from Luke is in the Gospels, and Luke is writing this because he's a physician and he knows about these things, and he writes that Jesus was passing through on a way to a town, and he passes by this colony of lepers. Now, leprosy was a term covered a wide variety of skin diseases and anything, but it was considered contagious. So when you had leprosy, you were made to go live outside the town. You could not live with your family. You could not see your friends. You couldn't go into town to trade. You couldn't go and buy and sell. You lost your job, and you were separated from society. Does this sound a little bit familiar to what's happening right now in the world? It was hard because their families could only see them from a distance, and they would leave food or needs somewhere for them to go and pick it up because they couldn't be in contact with each other. They could only watch their kids or family members and friends grow up from a distance. They were far off. No touch, no hugs, no love, nothing. And this one gets me is, the Bible even says they couldn't even touch the head of a dog, or the dog would have to be put away. That would kill me right there, not being able to touch my dogs or my cats. But do you see how sad that is? So even though that the illness itself was hard, the separation was even harder for the people to deal with. But you see, here comes Jesus walking along. He's got this huge crowd following him, and they're all listening intently on Jesus's teachings and all the things that he's saying. And as they are approaching this town, they hear in the distance a bunch of voices saying, "Stay away, stay away, we're unclean, we're unclean." That was a signal. That was something that they had to do to warn other people that they could not approach that area. "We have leprosy, don't come here." Now, how I picture this in my mind is I see Jesus look in that general direction, and I see the crowds look and then shift as far away on the other side of the path as they could go. "Stay away, stay away." But Jesus stands still. I can see Jesus locking eyes with this man standing there. Just in a moment. This man now feels kindness, mercy, tenderness. And it's just radiating off Jesus' body. So the man gets brave and he says to Jesus, "If you are willing, make me clean." Oh, wow. Not heal me, not fix me. Make me clean. Now we know from other lessons in the Bible that Jesus could heal people from afar. But Jesus didn't. Jesus reached for the man. A man who was unclean, a man who was untouchable, a man who was not supposed to be touched or come near. Jesus reaches his hand out to the man. And then I picture this in my brain. I want you to picture this. Jesus wrapping his arms around the man, the sick man, and that man collapsing into the arms of Jesus, crying his eyes out. Because it's been months, maybe years, before he's touched another person. Maybe he hasn't seen or talked to another human being in a very long time. And now this man gets to receive the best gift in the world. Human contact. And then I can see Jesus whispering, "You are made clean. Now go and tell everybody what you've witnessed here." It wasn't just about the healing. It was not just about him being able to return to his family and his community, but it was about receiving the love that he hasn't received in a very long time. And I know many of you are feeling like that right now too. I know I am. I miss my sister and I haven't seen her in a while. So you haven't hugged your cousins, or maybe you haven't hugged your grandparents for a very long time. But I'm gonna tell you something right now. Something that you can count on. That when you call out for the name of Jesus, when you reach out to him, Jesus will reach down and reach for you back. And he will wrap his arms around you. And if you need to, then you can collapse in his arms and cry like the man did. You know, we can feel so much comfort, so much bravery, so much strength from just knowing that Jesus hugs us when we need it most. So to your family that you have near you and that you can hug and touch, Give them a big giant hug. Give them a big giant touch. Love them deeply. Call out to Jesus, and he will hug you and deeply love you too. He already does. Let's pray. Gentle Jesus, you reach for us when we feel isolated and separated from the world. Hold us and pour out your love on us when we're feeling unloved and lonely. We pray, Father, that you show us those who don't know you yet so we can share this story with them and show them the great love that you give to us. And this is what we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's kids said, Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'm so glad to be able to be here with you today and sing His Eye is on the Sparrow. This piece has always been special to me and also to Ryan and his family. I sang it at my grandmother's church when I was in high school, and it's been a special piece for her. And we are so glad to be able to share it with you, as the words are really fitting for what we're going through today. So I hope that you will be touched by this piece.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. And I know He watches me.
Friends, let me share with you our scripture passage this morning. I'll be preaching from the 5th chapter of Luke. The title of the sermon this morning is, He is Willing and Able. Let me share with you from Luke 5, 12 through 16. While Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and begged him, Lord, if you are willing, can you make me clean? Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. I am willing, he said. Be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him. Then Jesus ordered him, don't tell anyone, but go and show yourself to the priest. Offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them. Yet the news about him spread all the more, so that crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Almighty and most merciful Lord, we do thank you and give you praise this day and every day as we come together once again in the hectic schedules of our lives, in the turmoil and chaos, as we put that out of our minds this day and come in humility and generosity and gratitude to worship you, our Lord. Be with us all as we enjoy this Sabbath rest and day. Be with us in our worship, and may my words be your words, Almighty Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. You know, as I looked at this passage today, I pondered why this seemingly simple story of Jesus curing a leper would have been shared by not only Luke, but also Matthew and Mark. All three of these gospel writers share almost verbatim the same story. Now, I learned in seminary that repetition in the Bible signifies importance. In my preliminary study of this scripture, I still couldn't see the significance of including this story three times. Now, don't get me wrong. Anytime someone is cured of a disease, it is a big deal. I just didn't quite understand why the story of the curing of this leper got so much attention. And I thought, well, maybe it was because diseases of the skin in first century Palestine were not afflictions that garnered a whole lot of compassion. It didn't have, for lack of a better word, the likability of, say, being cured of blindness or of deafness or a shriveled hand. Now, we know today that the word leprosy in the scriptures could mean any form of skin ailment or disease. It wasn't necessarily leprosy or what we have come to know as Hansen's disease. It could have been any disease that left one disfigured or what was referred to as unclean. Listen to how those who suffered from skin diseases were to behave under Jewish law, as this comes from Leviticus, the 13th chapter. It says, the person with such an infectious disease, they must wear torn clothes. They must let their hair be unkempt. They must cover the lower part of their face and cry out, unclean, unclean. As long as they have the infection, they remain unclean, and they must live alone and outside of the camp. I thought, wow, that's pretty harsh. So why did leprosy get the attention of Matthew, Mark, and Luke? Maybe it was because skin diseases were considered disgusting, that skin diseases were considered infectious social diseases. And maybe the gospel writers wanted to address or perhaps bring attention to the truth that fear and ignorance ruled people's hearts. People who were blind or deaf or lame were not deemed unclean. No, to be unclean was to be considered an outcast, a pariah, a person who had to be segregated. They were not included. Fast forward from the time of Levitical law to the time of Christ, 1,400 years, give or take a few, we find the same fear associated with certain diseases. And we do even today. Maybe, just maybe, the yearning to be clean is more paramount to the story than being cured. I want to say that again. Maybe the yearning to be clean is more paramount to the story than being cured. Now, the leper throws caution to the wind. They could have stoned him to death for being so bold to confront Jesus. But this shows just how desperate he must have been. Now, he also must have known about Jesus' ability to cure people, for he doesn't have any doubt whatsoever that Jesus can cure him. It is a foregone conclusion to him that Jesus can do it. What the leper wants to know is this: is he willing to do it? It's not can he, it's will he. Now, friends, isn't that the question we all have asked when we are facing desperation? Jesus, we know you can cure our mother. We know you can cure our father, our son, our daughter. We know that you can cure cancer. We know that you can reconstruct broken hearts. We know that you can remove disease. Jesus, we know you can. We have faith you can. But will you, Lord? Are you willing? Don't we all, in times of desperation, fall on our face to the ground like the leper in humble prayer and petition for Jesus, the great physician of all, to cure our diseases and the diseases of our loved ones? Of course we do. We know in our hearts that Jesus is not just willing, but he is able. But will he cure us? Will he hear our prayers? Amber Cohen, in her Christian blog, shared that her mother was diagnosed with MCTD back in 2003. And at the time, her doctors only gave her about 5 years to live. Mixed connective tissue disease, MCTD, is an extremely rare autoimmune disease. In fact, it is so rare that no one knows what causes it, and there is no treatment, no cure. It is a combination of four separate autoimmune diseases that manifest themselves in different ways with many different symptoms. In a nutshell, if you have MCTD, your body slowly kills itself. They really had no idea what to expect or how to treat her, so she became a living case study. One experimental treatment after the other only seemed to delay the disease, not stop it. Medicine masked her symptoms, but only for so long. Her fight was marked with visits to multiple specialists. She had a few close calls, rapidly declining quality of life. She finally, Amber said, succumbed to her illness in 2015, which was 12 years, not five, after her original diagnosis. Amber said that she prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, but her mother died anyway. Now, her mother was faithful to the end. Her mother trusted Jesus her entire life. She knew where she was going. She had made peace. She was free now. Amber knows this, and she is made new in heaven. But unlike the leper's story today, Amber was angry at God. Why wasn't my mother cured? We all have these difficult questions at some time in our life. The reason is twofold. First of all, Jesus never promises to cure us. Jesus never promises to cure us. And secondly, the Bible never proclaims that because we believe in God, we will be immune from the circumstances of the fallen world that we chose to live in. In fact, the Holy Scriptures, the Bible claims just the opposite. We will suffer, and we will experience all the calamities that this sick world has to offer. There is no promise of a physical cure for believers in our scriptures, period. So Amber went through a long period of grief over her mother's plight. She was struggling with her faith. She was doubting God's love. And this is what she finally came to through much prayer and through reading and meditating on God's Word and through many supportive Christian friends. She wrote these words. She said, "Ultimately, my mom was freed from her physical pain and suffering when her soul went to heaven. But she was never actually cured of her disease. However," she said, "I know she was healed when her time came, because through everything, she never lost faith in God." Her faith sustained her and healed the emotional pain she experienced after being told she was terminal. And when the end came, she was ready and she was at peace. Now, friends, did you catch the one word? The word that I believe makes all the difference today. You see, the leper never asked to be cured. He asked to be made clean. What Jesus was willing to do for the leper, He is willing to do for each one of us today. Jesus didn't say He was willing to cure. What He said is He is willing to heal, to make us clean again. There is a difference between curing and healing. Curing means eliminating all evidence of disease, while healing means becoming whole again. Being cured involves the physical realm. Healing comes on a spiritual and emotional level. It is a process we all go through in times of difficulty, seeking to be cured, but also seeking to be healed. Amber accepted her mother's healing, but her own healing took a little longer. She continues to share in her blog this. She said, "My healing over my mother's death took quite a bit longer. Longer to experience and accept. And it continues to be an ongoing process as she grieves and mourns." She says, "In the months following my mother's death, I walked through life numb to everyone and anything. In short, she says, I put on my big girl pants and I acted strong for my family, but I didn't dare let them see me blaming God for her illness and her death. I wouldn't let them see me weeping or screaming at God or cursing that He didn't save her. They couldn't watch as I sat at her tombstone, begging and pleading and bargaining with God to bring her back to me. They couldn't know how depressed I really was or how cheated I felt with all my friends who still had their moms. But she said, eventually I stopped blaming God for my mom's pain and suffering. And I stopped blaming God for my own pain and suffering. I came to the realization, she says, perhaps the conclusion God wanted me to reach all along, that suffering is a part of life. Not one person walks this earth without suffering in one way or another. She says, I learned that suffering itself does not come from God. I learned that through suffering, we are healed by our faith. Suffering forces us to depend on God, to give our struggles to God, and to seek His refuge and strength and healing power. Through faith and the grace of God, we are healed, but not necessarily cured of our physical sickness, though sometimes God does grant us both. Amen? Amber said ultimately that she learned this. The glory of God can be found in everything, even in our pain and suffering, for God is always there, ready and willing to heal our spirits and make us whole again, clean again. You see, this seemingly simple story is so much more than just curing a disease. It is about restoring a person. It is about returning a broken soul to wholeness. It is ultimately about redemption. It is about taking those who society deems to be disgusting and making them new again, accepted again, loved again. Friends, no person is too disgusting to be touched by our Lord. And it is our hearts and our spirits that need the ultimate healing. It dawned on me as I studied this scripture and as the Holy Spirit revealed this truth that the most important part of this story is not that Jesus did, in fact, cure and restore the leper. The most important part of the story to me is not even that Jesus was willing to help and have compassion on this man. The most important part of the story is not even that the man was made clean or freed from his affliction or freed from sin or freed from his shame or freed from uncleanliness. All of this is wonderful. It is fantastic. But the biggest and the greatest part of this story is this. Jesus reached out His hand and touched the man. Praise be to God. There is no one who is beyond the reach and the touch of God. There is no one beyond redemption. God knows everything about each and every one of us, knows every vile thought that was ever crossed our minds or hearts, knows our inclinations to sin, knows our dark secrets, knows every sin we have ever committed or will commit. God knows our hearts, our minds, our souls, our spirits, and God doesn't look at us and see the dirt. He looks at us and sees His beloved children. God looks at us even in the light of our sin, even in our dirt, and still reaches out his loving hand and touches our flesh, our hearts, our minds, our very spirits with his love and with his grace, with his compassion, and with his forgiveness. Oh, friends, there is no one Jesus will not touch. Because you see, we are all lepers. We are all lepers in one way or another. We are all unclean in one way or another. We are all in need of redemption. We all desire to be included, to be accepted, to be invited, to be loved. We all cry out to God, if you will, sooner or later, Lord, are you willing to make me clean? Not only willing, friends, he's able. You see, friends, when Jesus touched this unclean leper, he did more than make him clean. He did the unthinkable. He did the unimaginable. Jesus did what no one else had ever done in 1,400 years of their history. He touched the untouchable. He loved the unlovable. He forgave the unforgivable. Has he touched you? Has he made you clean today? Are you redeemed today by the cleansing touch of Jesus, by the blood he shed on the cross? There's a great song in our hymn book that Bill Gaither wrote back in 1963. And I'm going to share just a verse with you this morning. Wherever you are, wherever you're at home, if you want to join in, I want to invite you to do so. Since I met my blessed Savior, since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls. He touched me. Oh, he touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Let me tell you, friends, something happened, and now I know, because he touched me and made me whole. Will you pray with me? Almighty and most merciful God, I thank you that you touch us in so many ways in this old world, and that you make such a difference by making us clean again, that your spilt blood has made us once again righteous in front of God. No matter how many ways we fall short, no matter how many ways we disappoint you, Lord, you are always there to reach out your hand and to touch us with your love. We thank you that even though we all are unclean, you have healed us and made us clean again. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, as we close our service this morning, we hope that wherever you may be this morning, that our Lord Jesus has touched your heart. We pray that this Sabbath day be a blessed day of rest and peace for you. We are so excited here at Burn Factory that you remain connected, that you continue to give and continue to reach out to those in need in our community. We are so thankful that you continue to inspire us here, the staff, that you continue to support and uplift us and encourage us. And we are thankful and humbled by all the different ways that you continue to be the face of Jesus Christ in this world. At this time, as we close, I ask that you would bow down in humility and gratitude for the one who has made us clean. Let us pray. Almighty God, when your Son, our Savior, Jesus, healed and made clean the leper, he told people to not tell others about it. He didn't want his ministry to be known just for miracles. He wanted the people to understand the full scope, the full depth of his message. And yet his message could not be contained no matter what. News spread throughout the land of this man of God who loved everyone and who poured out compassion on everyone. Today, Almighty God, we know that your Son Jesus is so much more than just someone we reach out to when we are in need. Jesus is our everything. He is our all in all, our Savior. He is our friend, our authority. He is our comfort in the storm. He is our shepherd, our light, our way, our truth, our bread. He is our Lord. And Lord, we need you now. Come, Lord Jesus, heal our broken bodies. Heal our hopeless hearts. Heal our restless spirits. Heal our nation. Heal our wounds. Come, Lord Jesus, unify your church and your people. Comfort us in our time of challenge. Bring peace in our hearts during these times of dread and despair. Reach out for all to see and touch us with your hand of forgiveness and grace. Reach out your hand once again and make us clean. For those who suffer, touch them with the cure they need. Make them whole again. Heal their spirits. Let them know of your great love. Almighty and faithful God, let us all experience your touch this day and every day. Give us peace. Give us courage. Give us strength. Hear our prayer today for those that are in need. Supply their every need, Lord, we pray. And let your touch be felt. Your presence be known. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray together our family prayer by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, friends, may the Lord our God bless you and keep you this day. And may he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious. May our Lord God lift up his countenance upon you and bring you peace. And may you have a wonderful Sabbath today. With the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the power and the promise of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, start to fall, and all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Well, there was Jesus. In the way, and in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces.
Jesus
in the shadows of the alleys.
There